Jeff Trail's watch stopped at 9:55 p.m., the likely time he was struck 27 times with a claw hammer. His body was found inside David Madsen's loft on April 29th, 1997. Jeff was the U.S. Navy's poster boy. He commanded 42 men on board the USS Gridley, several of whom looked up to him as the manliest of men. Not a sissy. However, that's exactly how Jeff felt. He struggled immensely under the don't ask, don't tell policy, to the point Jeff felt compelled to accept 48 hours offer to speak out against it. He was at an extremely low point in his life upon meeting Andrew Cunanan. Living as outcasts pushed them to be incredibly loyal to one another. Although, their kinship might not have flourished if Andrew hadn't presented himself as a meal ticket. Like him and David, Jeff was a shopaholic. He bought several high-quality television sets, countless expensive suits, two pricey tennis rackets, and much, much more. Rumors circulated that Andrew paid Jeff a visit to receive back the several thousand dollars he was rightfully owed. It's probable Andrew didn't make the trip up north simply to commit murder, but to get a return on his investments. Whether or not he knew, Jeff was also strapped for cash. He had then recently asked to borrow $100 from a coworker just to get him through the weekend. For that reason, Andrew's request was likely shut down. Jeff's passing appeared to be the dire result of an argument gone terribly wrong, rather than a methodical plan. This was somewhat confirmed through a breadcrumb discovered in the St. Paul Pioneer Press. A joke for today, from David, who is an engineer, and I'm okay. An engineer, an architect, and an artist are having an argument. At that particular point in time, Jeff was working as an engineer, David was still working as an architect, and Andrew often considered himself to be an art expert. Law enforcement did manage to make contact with the St. Paul Pioneer Press, but their efforts were to no avail. The newspaper flat out refused to cooperate. No one had a clue where the ex-lovers disappeared to. That is, until the sun rose on May 3rd, 1997. One of the three bullets fired blew a hole straight through David's right eye. What's more, his devastating end was an indirect result of the police's sheer incompetence. Their portrayal of Andrew Cunanan has and will probably always be that of an organized killer. An odd choice considering how disorganized Jeff Trail and David Madsen's murders actually were. In 1980, Roy Hazelwood developed the stark differences between organized and disorganized crimes. Mentioned briefly in my analysis, the real story behind casting JonBenet, his concept was perfected through the FBI's Behavioral Science Unit. Organized killers carefully plan their crimes and go to great lengths to leave behind very little evidence, such as Jeffrey Dahmer, all while disorganized killers are overwhelmingly violent and tend to leave behind their victim's body exactly where the crime took place, such as Jack the Ripper. Let's circle back around to Jeff and David's deaths. They obviously check out in the extreme violence department. What's hardly noticed here, however, was the visibility of their bodies to the naked eye. Jeff was rolled up into an area rug, and David was left to rot out in the open near a tranquil lake. His body was dragged no more than 20 feet from where he was murdered. Both don't appear to be cold and calculated, but fiery and passionate at its most volatile. I personally believe law enforcement was well aware of this fact, yet chose a more organized narrative to explain away how badly they screwed the pooch. Jeff Trail's poor father, Stan Trail, was revealed his son's homosexuality in the same breath as every parent's waking nightmare. From the police's perspective, he and Ann Davis Trail were idiots for having no idea their youngest was gay, whereas Howard Madsen and Carol Madsen might as well be just as guilty as their son for blinding themselves to red flags that were never present to begin with. The belief these two deaths were triggered by a love triangle gone awry contaminated any genuine remorse law enforcement might have had for their parents. Plus, the police were convinced Andrew Cannonan was the captive to David Madsen's captor right up until it was far too late. All because his loft stored a lifeless Jeff. Howard had even been told while David was missing that he and Andrew were probably just partying on the French Riviera together. This dumbfounding joke was tactfully relayed by one of the case's many investigators, Bob Titchich, an old coot who had no clue what bedside manners actually meant. He centered each of his wild theories around an incriminating black duffel bag. Again, all because David's loft stored it. The bag contained empty restraint boxes, steroids, pornography, .40 caliber bullets, and a holster. One of Bob's theories involved David killing Jeff in a steroids-filled rage. Yeah. This was quickly debunked when Bob found out the mystery bag was in fact labeled. It belonged to Andrew.
Oh my god!
What's worse, this realization didn't occur until 6 days after the bag was discovered. Now, I'm going to refrain from detailing too much about Andrew Cannonan's third and fourth victims, mainly because both men's presumed heterosexuality straight up impacted who received the most publicity. Don't worry, I'll still be giving the basic deets involved in their murders. It will only appear less so when compared and contrasted with the others. Marilyn Miglin knew something was terribly wrong on May 4th, 1997, when her ever-organized husband, Lee Miglin, failed to show at O'Hare International Airport. Little did she know, one of the Windy City's most prominent real estate developers was lying in the garage of their home, over 400 miles from where David Madsen's body was located. The coroner concluded Lee had died from multiple stab wounds and blunt force trauma to the chest. Despite how his passing was dramatically portrayed by the media, not a single shred of evidence came to the conclusion he was sexually assaulted or ritualistically tortured. Instead, it appeared to be a means to an end. That means entailing the Grand Theft Auto of Alexis. In 2018, Vulture fact-checked the assassination of Gianni Versace by recruiting Luisa Yanez, a journalist who reported on the case extensively once it reached the Miami Herald. She reminisced that the Miglin murder was always the thing that made the murders come alive. Before that, I don't even remember having any knowledge that there was a guy who killed two other men, but with Miglin, he was well known. This was somebody prominent in the community of Chicago. Things changed after Miglin. People are really looking for Cannonan now. This is not just a guy killing people he knows. Now, he's a spree killer. Production design plays a vital role in the assassination of Gianni Versace and how it relays its true events, especially when Jeff's struggles are depicted alongside Gianni's within episode 5. They knock on their own symbolic closet doors. Jeff's being the red door to his spa on 48 Hours, and Gianni's being the white door to his exclusive with the Advocate. How they each choose to come out greatly impacts their environments. The hotel room Gianni interviews in is warmly lit and invigoratingly open. The motel room Jeff interviews in, meanwhile, is coldly lit and stiflingly small. By making the real-life choice to come out in the shadows, the scene depicts him as the physical embodiment of fear. Utterly opposite from Gianni Versace, who chooses to stand firmly by his partner, Antonio D'Amico. The only commonality these scenarios share is the lingering hues of one primary color. On the one hand, blue can signify peace. On the other, it can be a visual representation for isolation. In this instance, neither are wrong. What's that? I've created another little segue for myself just to talk more about color palettes? Why, yes. Yes, I did. If red is evoked, you can bet your bottom dollar that either one of two possibilities could be going on. Andrew Kananen's alter ego has broken through, or danger is lurking near. Production designers will sometimes risk assigning certain colors to certain characters. Done well, it can add an entirely new layer of unfiltered subtext. Factually and fictionally speaking, I'd be hard-pressed to deny the significance red plays in Andrew's identity. Both the blood and pickup truck left behind were invaluable to law enforcement's manhunt once it reached an all-time high in lunacy. Therefore, assigning red to Andrew makes perfect sense. The assassination of Gianni Versace doesn't really delve into his drug and alcohol addiction. A massive shame, as it could have easily answered many of the season's posed questions. What it does achieve is the weaponization of red. Whenever Andrew indulges in drugs or alcohol, he's draped in red. Whenever Andrew gives in to his alter ego, he's draped in red. In essence, it conveys the very real truth that addiction can act as a major player in any tragedy. On December 2nd, 1946, Giovanni Maria Versace was figuratively born on palace steps rather than inside the palace itself. Like Andrew Kananen, he was nonetheless doted on, particularly by his mother, Franca Versace, and the 45 seamstresses she employed. Franca's traditionalistic father swayed her away from pursuing a career in medicine. He believed women should only strive for feminine careers. This unfortunate motto turned out to be extremely fortunate for Franca, as it led her on the path to opening a successful sewing business. Gianni quickly learned what it meant to be bloody, sweaty, and teary-eyed by observing his mother's resilient work ethic. He also matured in a stable environment full of nourishment and love. Healthy ingredients to a life Andrew yearned for but lacked in spades. Because Franca was denied her dreams, she was quick to encourage Gianni's growing interest in fashion. He swiftly ascended from ordering to designing clothes, which eventually led him to leave his southern roots behind for the exciting industrialism of northern Italy. 1978, the same year Gianni's one and only love succumbed to liver disease, he launched his label. Franca's business was always family-owned and operated, hence why Gianni never hesitated to follow suit. He recruited his older brother, Santo Versace, and younger sister, Donatella Versace. Gianni's top priorities were to retain all creative control and remain completely independent. Probably for the best, as he was an ingenious marketing strategist. In vulgar favors, Andrew Kananen, Gianni Versace, and the largest failed manhunt in U.S. history, a promoter dubbed the King of the Night summarized up the powerful results of Gianni's hidden talents. The average Joe walking down the street didn't recognize the Gianni Versace the fashion crowd knew, says Louis Canalis. The power of Versace was in his advertising money. The amount he spent guaranteed him editorial coverage, and at the same time, to expand it, he'd multiply it by having Elton John or Sting around, so that at the same time the press was covering Versace, these stars are getting publicity and press they wouldn't be getting otherwise. At the same time, they're helping open up new markets for buying his clothes. To outsiders, Gianni's world was the brightest it's ever been. To him, it was perhaps the darkest. Nothing could quell the tremendous loss of a mama's boy losing his mother. Not even the endless array of courtships he initiated with dark-haired, sun-kissed men. Gianni Versace and Antonio D'Amico remained open regardless of their in-a-relationship status. They were quietly known to select potential one-night stands from gay-friendly clubs. So, it isn't out of the realm of possibility that Gianni would have spotted the dark-haired, sun-kissed Andrew among a sea of admirers at Colossus, especially considering both men had heavily ingrained themselves into the nightclub scene. Nevertheless, Gianni's family has continued to denounce the countless claims supporting this chance encounter as factual, particularly those originating from Andrew's inner circle. For them, it added a layer of legitimacy to some of his wilder claims. At 8:44 a.m. on July 15th, 1997, Charles Podesta declared to a police dispatcher that his boss had been shot. Antonio D'Amico and a friend he invited over to play a few rounds of tennis with, Lazaro Quintana, were the first to approach the steps of Casa Casarina, a 16-bedroom tropical palace located in Miami Beach. The palace steps Gianni's life figuratively began on had literally become his final resting place.
Well, almost.
He was pronounced dead 40 minutes after two 40-caliber bullets were fired. Both struck him in the head. Gianni was unlocking his wrought iron gate when targeted. The first bullet shot straight through him. Upon impacting the gate, it shattered into a million particles, one of which struck a passing dove, killing it instantly. Rest in peace, my feathery friend. This fluke resulted in law enforcement temporarily believing Gianni's murder was a hit, as dead birds have long been associated with the mafia. Help arrived so quickly after that the man responsible was still walking down the block when spotted by Lazaro. And it wasn't a member of the mafia. He pursued Andrew Cannonan down a nearby alley until threatened with the very same gun used a mere minute ago on Gianni Versace. Luckily, a sixth victim wasn't in the cards.
The police never could have predicted the sheer cultural impact of their shortcomings,
especially considering how close they once came to an actual arrest. Through a phone inside Lee Miglin's Lexus, law enforcement had the power to locate Andrew Cunanan. They were relieved to hear that their then 9 days of hell might finally reach a screeching halt.
Then, as quickly as the police's point of attack came, it had to be scrapped. The media got wind and were quick to blow law enforcement's cover. They were mortified.
So much so that those working closely on the case believed their mistake came at the cost of yet another man's life.
May 9th, 1997 proceeded just like any other day, until a witness spotted Bill Reese's pickup truck racing out of Finns Point National Cemetery. Alarm bells rang loud and clear. Individuals who lived near never thought of its sole caretaker as reckless. Soon after, the police arrived to find Bill's body, slumped against the wall within the basement of the cemetery's office. Because it's so far removed from the general public, many couldn't even begin to fathom how his presence was uncovered.
Investigators believed Bill's daily ritual of driving his truck near the main road in order to pick up the mail may have resulted in Andrew spotting, then following him back to Finns Point National Cemetery.
No one heard the single gunshot to the head that ended Bill's life.
Andrew spent the few months after murdering his fourth victim downing vodka, partying until sunrise, and consuming a stupid amount of crack. He spent the few days after murdering his fifth victim treating a nasty stomach wound, searching desperately for a phony passport, and escaping reality through books.
Since Andrew was a child, he wrapped himself up in the comforting world of literature. They became his cocoon, a gateway to a life overflown with love and prosperity. In a way, the lies Andrew told were plagiarisms of the books he read. Similar to the make-believe lives Andrew grew up reading about, he longed for an aristocratic yet fantastical existence. Gianni Versace presented himself as living just that, even though his life was also riddled with turmoil.
Gianni battled inner ear cancer, took on complicated relationships, and received mixed reactions post-announcing
announcing he was gay via the Advocate.
Close friends recalled the years leading up to Gianni's untimely end difficult to witness. He was tired and bitter of the world. A very different image from what the also tired and bitter Andrew viewed from afar. The fictional chapters written specifically for his fictional life were mere extensions of the promise he had made to himself as an insecure schoolboy.
Before the bishop's school accepted Andrew into their esteemed circle, he was asked to describe what his hopes and dreams were for the future. Success, a house overlooking the ocean, 2 Mercedes, 4 beautiful children, 3 beautiful dogs, and a good relationship with God.
A picturesque idea that never really withered.
Andrew Kananen's lifeless body was discovered by a SWAT team on July 23, 1997.
He had committed suicide 5 weeks shy of his 28th birthday.
Underscoring the first 7 minutes of the assassination of Gianni Versace is Adagio in G minor, a haunting tune that was either dreamt up by Tommaso Albinoni or Remo Gisotto.
Its own shrouds in mystery carry weight while simultaneously provoking a sense of dread.
And the scene revels in it.
Example? Look no further from how Gianni and Andrew are introduced.
From a worm's eye view, Gianni stands confidently on the balcony of Casa Caserina. He's a nobleman at the highest point of his life. From a bird's eye view, Andrew sits nervously near the shores of Miami Beach. He's a common man at the lowest point of his life.
Camp is rife here in an effort to relay how sorrowful these true events were. This wasn't just a killing spree, but an all-American take on a modern-day Greek tragedy. The People's Princess was in attendance at Gianni's funeral. 40 days later, she died in a car accident, which unfortunately meant the manhunt was quicker to be forgotten than it was to remain. To me, this case was a blunt allegory for those neglected by the US government during the AIDS epidemic. Each of these men should possess a special place in the forefront of our minds. That includes Andrew Kananen.
All 6 lives were victimized by law enforcement and the media's warped perspectives coated in a thick layer of homophobia. With that in mind, 1997 should not be forgotten, but embraced as one of human history's darkest and most telling years.
Thank you guys so much for watching. Oh my god, this took such a long time to do, mainly because I was visiting my family while I was writing this in California in the United States. Also, if you have any ideas for any upcoming videos related to true crime, let me know in the comment section below. Please like this video, subscribe, and ring the bell to get notified about any other videos I do. Thank you so much for watching, and I'll see you next time. Bye guys!